Poltergeist was the brainchild of the greatest director in the world, Steven Spielberg. As a youngster growing up in Scottsdale, Arizona, he took great delight in frightening his two sisters, Ann and Nancy, with practical jokes or even ghost stories. Writer and producer Steven Spielberg.
I love ghost stories. I've always loved them. And I used to frighten my sisters with them. I used to frighten myself with them. And I just like telling ghost stories. It's fun around the campfire when it's, you know, the only light is the lights on your faces. And if you take a few steps back, it's pitch black. Without a flashlight, you can't see your way back to your tent. And it was always fun thinking I'd tell a really scary story. And everybody will be so scared going back to their tents. And I wound up not frightening them as much as I frightened myself. I keep myself up awake. I turn my flashlight on. I just have a night light until the batteries went to yellow and then disappeared, you know, and I'd have no light at all. I would always wind up frightening myself more than other people.
Spielberg himself, like many youngsters, had fears too. In particular, clowns, and even a scary-looking tree outside his bedroom window. As Spielberg grew up, he shifted his focus and then used his abilities as a movie maker to scare the world out of its wits with the release of the 1975 horror blockbuster Jaws, based on Peter Benchley's best-selling book. The success of Jaws led Spielberg to direct his passion project, Close Encounters of the Third Kind, in 1977. The film was the second most successful film at the box office after George Lucas's epic space opera, Star Wars Episode IV: A New Hope. In 1981, Lucas and Spielberg would team up to bring us to the screen Indiana Jones and the Raiders of the Lost Ark. While Raiders was about to be released in the summer of 1981, Spielberg punched out a story treatment for Poltergeist. It utilized a lot of his memories growing up in Arizona and incorporated most of the things that terrified him. Both Spielberg and co-producer Frank Marshall took Poltergeist to executives at Metro-Goldwyn-Mayer. MGM agreed to finance the film instantly. But the project hit a snag. Spielberg wouldn't be allowed to direct it. A clause in his contract for Universal Pictures stated that he wasn't allowed to take any other directing jobs while directing Universal's other big project, E.T. the Extraterrestrial. Spielberg would stay on as producer, alongside Marshall, so the first order of business was to find a director. Spielberg tapped Tobe Hooper, being a big fan of Hooper's debut film, The Texas Chainsaw Massacre, the film that introduced us to the character Leatherface. To write the script, Spielberg met with Michael Grace and Mark Victor, writers of the action film Death Hunt. At first, Spielberg tapped the duo to work on a screenplay for a remake of the Victor Fleming film, A Guy Named Joe. At that same meeting, Spielberg told him he was developing a ghost story of his own. Grace and Victor told Spielberg that they would rather do the ghost story. With the script and director in place, Spielberg and Hooper next set their sights on casting. The first person cast was Jo Beth Williams, who initially turned it down, but then reconsidered when she found out Spielberg's name was attached to it. It was Williams who suggested Craig T. Nelson, having worked together on the Gene Wilder-Richard Pryor comedy Stir Crazy. Other actors cast include Academy Award winner Beatrice Straight, Dominique Dunn, sister of actor Griffin Dunn, Oliver Robbins, James Caron, and Zelda Rubinstein. But the most difficult role to cast was the role of Carol Ann Freeling, the young girl targeted by the titular poltergeist. One of the youngsters reading for the role was Drew Barrymore. Spielberg, however, felt that she wasn't right with Poltergeist, but would be right for his own film, which was E.T. While in the MGM commissary, Spielberg came across a 5-year-old girl named Heather O'Rourke. O'Rourke was visiting her sister Tammy while she was making a film called Pennies from Heaven. Spielberg then offered the role of Carol Ann to the young girl. The initial audition wasn't successful, as she was unable to keep a straight face throughout. Seeing something special about her, Spielberg called her back for another audition. This time, she brought with her a scary storybook. This time around, the audition was a success, as she just had to scream. She screamed until she burst into tears. She won the role. In May of 1981, production of Poltergeist began in Simi Valley, California. It was a difficult shoot due to the sweltering heat, and even the neighbor householders had to put up with the constant shooting that would sometimes happen until 3 in the morning. When the production was moved to the sound stages of MGM, a 3-month writer's strike happened. As Toby Hooper continued his duties as director, Steven Spielberg was in the midst of pre-production on E.T. For the most part, the young cast members had fun on the set. The adult actors, however, were always on edge and practically exhausted from the physically demanding action set pieces, such as the scene where Jo Beth Williams is physically dragged up the walls and ceiling by an unseen ghost. The most frightening scene in the movie was the scene where Jo Beth Williams is surrounded by decaying skeletons in the house's unfinished swimming pool. The scene was shot on the old Esther Williams stage and had lights above the pool. Williams was concerned that one of those lights would fall in. Spielberg, however, kept Williams at ease. Actress Jo Beth Williams.
Steven Spielberg put on waders and waded into the pool and stood, you know, out of camera range on the side in the water. And he said, I want you to know that if a light falls in and it's going to electrocute you, it'll electrocute me too. And I felt much better. And fortunately, neither of us fried.
For many years, a rumor has been circulating that Steven Spielberg ghost-directed Poltergeist, no pun intended. Mick Garris, Toby Hooper's lifelong friend and horror legend, as well as some of the cast members, set the record straight. Mick Garris.
I got to watch him work on Poltergeist. I was on the set. His mark on the movie is indelible. Steven Spielberg is a very powerful producer. He hired Toby because he loved Texas Chainsaw Massacre. When the storm is happening and all of the coffins are coming up and spilling out all the corpses and the like, it's very surreal and very Toby. You know, that I think is probably the most Toby Hooper scene in the movie. And yet it's a collaboration of two incredibly powerful and unique filmmaking minds who come to the same destination from opposite directions.
Actor James Caan.
I saw Toby there every day, and I saw Spielberg there every day. And on any picture, the producer talks to you, and the director talks to you. I didn't think anything odd about it, about the arrangement.
Jo Beth Williams.
I mean, Toby certainly had his fair share of input, too. We're clear that we were working with both of these people. It didn't affect me. I was happy to have both of them around. So, you know, if there were resentments, they were kept away from me.
Principal photography on Poltergeist wrapped in August of 1981. To oversee the visual effects, Spielberg selected Richard Edlund, then an employee of George Lucas's effects company, Industrial Light and Magic. Edlund was already an Oscar winner for Star Wars, Empire Strikes Back, and Raiders of the Lost Ark. Some of the effects include the floating objects, which were essentially optically composited. It was said to have taken 9 months to get right. The ghost effects were sometimes animated or puppets shot underwater in slow motion against a black backdrop. The throat of the house was never part of the physical set, but a miniature filmed separately and matted in using the optical printer. For the scene in which Martin Kaysla peels away his own face was accomplished with a model head with peel-away latex rubber and loaded with artificial blood. The hands pulling the face apart was actually Steven Spielberg's hands. For the famous scene of the house imploding, a model house hung on steel cables was sucked through a funnel vacuum, and the actors were shot against blue screen. The finishing touch is the haunting, melodic music score composed by Academy Award winner Jerry Goldsmith. The central theme of the film is a piece called Carol Ann's Theme. The piece is made to represent the blissful suburban life as well as the young girl Carol Ann. When Poltergeist was first submitted to the Motion Picture Association of America, it was given an R rating. Spielberg and Hooper appealed to the ratings board, and it was finally given a PG rating. On June 4th, 1982, Poltergeist was released to overwhelming positive response. But come a week later, Spielberg's own film, E.T., came in like a torpedo and blew it off the number one spot at the box office. Nevertheless, the film was a commercial success, earning more than $77 million in the United States alone. It would go on to receive 3 Academy Award nominations for original score, sound effects editing, and visual effects. All were defeated by E.T. Needless to say, 1982 was a good year for Steven Spielberg. In 1986, Poltergeist 2, The Other Side was released, continuing the plight of the Freeling family against the paranormal, and was a box office hit despite mixed reviews. In 1988, Poltergeist 3 was released and crashed and burned at the box office. From 1996 to 1999, the TV series Poltergeist the Legacy appeared on TV, lasting for 4 seasons. And in 2015, producer Sam Raimi produced a remake, starring Sam Rockwell and Jared Harris, and was a moderate success at the box office, but many claimed to be inferior to the 1982 classic. Since then, the series has been dormant. But rumor has it that Anthony and Joseph Russo of Avengers Infinity War and Endgame will mount a reboot of the series. When that will happen is anybody's guess. Since the release of Poltergeist, the film has been honored numerous times. The American Film Institute picked it as one of the most heart-pounding movies, and the line, "They're here," as one of the most famous lines in film history. Bravo also picked The Clown Attack as one of the scariest movie moments. Universal Studios' Halloween Horror Nights even did a walkthrough attraction, showing us that Poltergeist hasn't lost its magic to enthrall us and even scare us. Now, I know a lot of you watching this video are wondering about the so-called Poltergeist curse. Now, for those of you who don't know about the Poltergeist curse, it started when, on October 30th of 1982, 4 months after the release of Poltergeist, actress Dominique Dunn was strangled by her abusive boyfriend, John Sweeney. She was taken to Cedars-Sinai Hospital and put on life support, and about 5 days later was taken off of life support and finally passed away at the age of 22. Sweeney was eventually found guilty of voluntary manslaughter and was sentenced to 6 years in prison. He only served 3.5. In Poltergeist 2, The Other Side, the beast that haunts the Freeling family is personified in the form of a doomsday preacher, Henry Kane, played in the film by Julian Beck. Now, his gaunt physical appearance was due to the fact that he had been diagnosed with stomach cancer in 1983. When he signed on to play Kane in the film, he was gravely ill. Just 7 months before the film's release, Beck died after living 18 months with stomach cancer. In that same film, Native American actor Will Sampson, who played the role of the shaman Taylor, had died a year later due to a combination of kidney failure, preoperative malnutrition, and a fungal infection following a heart and lung transplant. The most tragic passing was during the making of Poltergeist 3. During that time, Heather O'Rourke was at the time thought to have Crohn's disease and was put on steroidal injection, which resulted in the swelling of the face. On January 31st of 1988, while production on Poltergeist 3 was put on hold, O'Rourke experienced flu-like symptoms. The following morning, she collapsed at her home. She was rushed to the hospital, and while en route, her heart stopped. Paramedics did revive her and was immediately rushed through surgery. She survived the surgery, but then suffered another cardiac arrest. She was pronounced dead at the age of 12. The cause of death was ruled as a congenital stenosis of the bowels complicated by septic shock. Her death resulted in the MGM marketing department not wanting to exploit the tragedy, made Poltergeist 3 a hard movie to market. Now, what has to be distinctly understood is that only two of these deaths were avoidable, Dominique Dunn and Heather O'Rourke. The others, Julian Beck and Will Sampson, were not only unavoidable, they were inevitable. And those two died after completing Poltergeist 2. Dominique Dunn had an abusive boyfriend, and what happened to her could have happened to almost anybody who's been in an abusive relationship. There's nothing supernatural involved. Also, what happened to Heather O'Rourke was the result of medical negligence, and it's a tragic shame that that happened to someone that young. I think the fact that Dunn and O'Rourke died way too young makes people want to blame it on some kind of otherworldly phenomenon, and then it would make more sense to them. But these were just coincidental and nothing more. Well, what about the use of real skeletons, I can hear some of you saying. The truth is, movie productions used real skeletons all the time. In the 1931 film Frankenstein, they used a real skeleton. In House on Haunted Hill by William Castle, they used a real skeleton. None of those films are cursed. If indeed the movies are cursed, why hasn't it affected Steven Spielberg? He wrote and produced the film, for God's sake. Toby Hooper went on to direct other projects since Poltergeist, and what makes Joe Beth Williams and Craig D. Nelson any different? They still went on to have pretty successful careers since Poltergeist. Hell, Craig T. Nelson is the voice of Mr. Incredible. Still, people believe that these films are cursed. I personally don't think so. The first time I saw Poltergeist was when my mother rented it at a video store. and I remember being terrified of the film and thought it was a pretty good ghost story. It took the haunted house story out of the gothic, decrepit, haunted mansions that we see in other movies and TV shows and placed it in colorful suburbia. The visual effects reminded me of what was done in Raiders of the Lost Ark and Ghostbusters. Only later I found out that the same visual effects team worked on both movies. It was actually the first film I saw directed by Toby Hooper. Obviously, I was too young to see the movie that got him to the attention of Steven Spielberg. But still, I felt this film was more of a Spielberg film. But as I rewatched the film after seeing Texas Chainsaw Massacre, it does have that creep shock factor of Texas Chainsaw, combined with the elaborate production value you would see in Steven Spielberg's other films. I also had no idea that there were sequels, and I did manage to see the second one on TV, but not in its entirety, as it was usually on late at night. But I would always come across the scene where Julian Beck would show up at the front porch and it's raining. I remember one of my sisters saying how terrified she was of this guy and how unsettling his Cheshire Cat grin and gaunt features were. It wasn't until much later when I did a little research and discovered that he was dying of cancer. Wasn't as good as the first film, but I thought it had some really great creepy moments. The third movie is bad, but I still find myself watching it. It does have some creative ideas, and the use of mirrors I thought was pretty clever, but is let down by weak characters, confusing plot, and god-awful ending. I have yet to see the remake. I've been hearing a lot of conflicting opinions on the thing. Still, Poltergeist by Steven Spielberg and Toby Hooper is still the one that reigns supreme over all the ghost story films, both past and present. So in closing, Poltergeist is a good, solid ghost story. It made it believable, and that everything we see is something that could happen to almost anybody, anywhere. The visual effects hold up even after 40 years, and still has the ability to scare any viewer. So if you want a good ghost story, look no further than Steven Spielberg and Toby Hooper's masterpiece of supernatural horror.